Yeah, so should I start?
Yeah.
So first, welcome Puneet, and welcome Tanaya. Tanaya has of course been part over here, has been part of the sessions. So Puneet Sethi, practicing architect, principal architect, IAD Studio Gurgaon, chairman, SPA alumni, chairman IIA Haryana chapter. Puneet, I have already done a mini introduction earlier before you joined in also. So
yeah, you don't need to go further.
No, we do. Now this is the format. We have to follow this. So yeah. Architect Puneet Sethi graduated from School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi in 1989 and has been in active architecture practice since 1990. He is a principal architect at his consultancy firm IAD Studio in Gurgaon. Puneet has been actively associated with the Indian Institute of Architects. He is currently the chairman of IIA Haryana chapter. He has served as editor of newsletter of IIA Northern chapter Vastu Sambad and as the editor of IIA National newsletter, including serving as a member of the editorial committee of Journal of IIA. He is currently the chairman of SPA Alumni New Delhi and has also served as member of the general council of SPA New Delhi. Puneet is also associated with teaching of architecture as a visiting faculty and external examiner at various institutions over the last 13 years and has guided various candidates of IIE examinations for their architectural thesis. Before Puneet wears so many hats and is such a vibrant person, and he is the heart and soul of our Haryana chapter. So welcome Puneet. I will introduce Tanaya. We have already interacted with Tanaya Verma, associate professor, Sushant School of Art and Architecture, Ansal University. Tanaya Verma holds a bachelor's and a master's degree in architecture from Nagpur University. Currently in the process of submitting a doctoral research titled The Study of Climate Responsive Vernacular Architecture of Bikaner, she has published papers in national and international journals and also authored a chapter in the book. She is an academician with 20 plus years of experience and currently working as an associate professor at Sushant School of Art and Architecture, Gurgaon. I will like to add, Tanaya takes care of all, she is the head of our examination department of the school, and she takes that role she enacts that role very easily because it's a very, very tough role. And of course, she's been teaching advanced building construction for a long while. And so that is, we will. So over to you, Puneet and Tanaya. Yeah.
Puneet, you're on mute.
Okay. Yeah, hi. Did you want me to share the presentation from here, or Arunam, would you be sharing it from there?
I'll share it.
I can share it also, I think.
You'll find it difficult because then otherwise.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Fine. You could share it, and then I say
just
next.
Just a minute. I'm opening it. 1 second.
You know, while she opens the presentation, you know, I think it was a very interesting session that we had with Prashansa and Himanshu a little while ago. And I'm sure all teachers who are there in this session would have suddenly become students themselves and would be wanting to, you know, learn so many things out of Himanshu. Software is a very, very powerful medium, and it is here to stay. It has already become part of our daily lives, our practices in our offices, and it is very important for all teachers to also gear themselves up so that they are able to teach the subjects in a much better manner. you know, I must thank Sushant School for giving me this opportunity to share my views with you. In fact, all of you on the in the session are all colleagues from the academic world, and there is nothing that you know you all don't know. But it's just, you know, I'll try and bring in my perspective as to how building construction is being taught, or you know what needs to be looked at as a teacher. So just to give you a brief background, my relationship with academics started in 2006, and typically, you know, as it happens, you know, at one party, you know, we were trying to tell one of our seniors, you know, what kind of students you are producing. You know, they don't know this, they don't know that. You know, what kind of teaching is good. You know, when I went to teach design, I also realized that it is not a very easy thing to do. And I also believe that, you know, it is the duty of every architect who's practicing to, you know, try and devote some time to teaching so that, you know, you are able to share your experiences and learnings with the next level of the next generation of architects in the making. And perhaps this is the reason why even Council of Architecture stipulates that, you know, some percentage, maybe 25% of the faculty must come from the professional industry, so that what is happening in the profession should be brought into our studios. So with this background, you know, I try and spend a few hours every week to teach building construction at the third year level, whatever limited time that I can devote. And third year, interestingly, is the year the students start using software for their drawings, both in design and in construction and so on. So, you know, that brings in the next level of challenge for teaching building construction at the third year level. Can I have my presentation on, Aruna?
I think she's having some trouble locating your presentation. That's why she put Tanaya's
It's coming. It's on. Just a second. I've got it.
Acha, okay.
Is that there? Is it there?
It's buffering. No.
No?
No?
No, not yet.
Okay.
No,
one second.
Ma'am, try presenting again.
Yeah, I'll do it again.
Now it's coming.
Yes, yeah, got it.
Yeah.
So, okay, Tanaya and I would be, you know, talking about the topic, project-based approaches in building construction, sites and other issues. And I will try and share with you what my opinion about project-based approach in building construction is. And I'll take you through a series of slides and try and communicate with you my perspective. Now, let me reiterate that most of you are familiar with what I'm going to say. It's just that, you know, I'll try and put the idea in my own words. And if it helps, I'll be very happy. So we could go to our next slide. So this is typically the relationship diagram of architectural education. I just tried to, you know, put all the bubbles together as to see what all goes on into architectural education, with architectural design, working drawings, history, structure, sociology, etc. And all this must lead in making a student capable enough to eventually go into professional practice. Now, professional practice does not necessarily mean that one has to go and open up an office, but you know, to be able to join the profession is what I mean here. So these are all the subjects that, you know, go in as far as the teaching of architectural education is concerned. Yeah, next. You know, in our architectural education, it so happens that architectural design is just the key area.
Srijani, switch off your mic, please. Srijani, switch off your mic. Just a sec, let me tell you.
Think how? No.
can't mute her because she is the admin. There she goes.
Yeah, she's there. Okay. So, you know, architecture and design has been the key area in making of an architect, always predominantly focused on architectural design. And the understanding and knowledge of all subjects is very important to enhance the creative thought process that goes behind every design exercise. Now, this is something that we all experience every day in our offices, in our studios, subconsciously. The understanding of all subject goes into whatever we are doing. And this fundamental must be remembered by every teacher, whichever subject you are teaching. And in the two-way relationship between design and other subjects, the central most important aspect is the knowledge and skill of drawings. Now, this has been my mantra so far, 1984, when I joined the School of Architecture till date, in the last 36 years. This mantra, please go back to the previous slide. This mantra has not changed. Go back, Arna. Arna, can you go back? Yeah, back. Yeah, thanks. No, next. Yeah, okay, please wait here. Yeah. So, in the last 36 years, I haven't changed this mantra of mine. And I still believe that the skill and knowledge of producing a drawing happens to be the key. And, you know, for all architects who are here, one very important thing that we must always remember is that architectural drawing is our means of communication with the outside world. Drawings lend unidirectional support to conceptualization of ideas. Now, whichever way you produce a drawing, whether you produce it manually, whether you produce it on a software, is irrespective. But drawings will lend that unidirectional support to conceptualization of ideas, and every drawing has a purpose. We do not produce a given drawing for everything. Every purpose will be satisfied with a different kind of a drawing. And this is something that also needs to be driven every time we are teaching at the school. And I have been told that there is a debate going around, and I'm still wondering what that debate is. So if there is a debate, you know, we'll come across that. Next. You know, typically architects produce three types of drawings. You are all familiar with this. So I will focus on what is taught in the construction studio. In building construction, we are typically teaching students how to produce working drawings or what we call construction drawings. Now, it is very essential for us to understand and as well as make students understand that why these drawings are made. So before even understanding what goes into making this drawing, my focus has always been to first try and explain to students why these drawings are produced. That these drawings will be produced by are produced to be used by contractors or fabricators to erect or manufacture buildings or their components. And these drawings will also be used by other consultants for design and detailing of their areas of specialization. Therefore, these drawings must contain very accurate dimensions of the project as a whole or its components in parts, and must clearly indicate materials, finishes, and their juxtaposition. Now, you know, the last two points could have been written above, and the points written at number one and two could have been below. But I still believe that the fundamental of why construction drawings are produced must be understood by students, and that has to be reinforced. Many a times when we talk to students meet interns or people who've graduated, when they want to come and join your offices, many a times they are not aware of the importance of construction drawings and working drawings. I personally believe that this is something that all teachers must focus on and drive the point home. And therefore, I still ask the question, why is there a debate? I don't see any reason for a debate to ensue here. Yeah, next. Building construction, I think, is the lifeline of architecture. And we must understand that no matter what we conceive in our brains, no matter what we try and sketch, unless it is built, people will never be able to experience architecture. Architecture cannot be experienced on paper or on your computers or your software. It will have to be experienced by people in its built form, and people can only use Spaces through the materials and the finishes. Now, you know, if I have to use a room, I have to be standing or on the floor, I have to be sitting on a piece of furniture or on a table to be doing what I'm doing. So to be able to enjoy or to be able to experience architecture, we have to use Spaces, the materials and the finishes. There are both the tangible and the intangible of finishes, the visual character, the texture, the color that we see. And yes, the intangibles come out of the neatness and the accuracy, etc., of, you know, how the construction has happened. You know, when you go to see the Taj Mahal, you just see that one material which has been used in such an elaborate manner. And the neatness, the accuracy, the way the whole thing has been finished brings forth the tangible and the intangible experiences of architecture. And as teachers of building construction, I think our focus should be to make students understand four fundamental things about construction drawings. Number one, these drawings must be accurate. Number two, they must be technically correct. Number three, they should be without any ambiguity. They should be simple to understand. And the fact that they are our language of communication with the people is also very important. You know, for example, why should dimensions be accurate? You know, in your design studio, if you say that, okay, the classroom that you've designed is 5810 by 9325, is not very important. So even if the students say that, okay, you know, the classroom that I've designed is about 5800 by 9300, that suits my conversation with him. But when it comes to construction, the dimension cannot say that approximately make the room as 5800 by 9300. No, I will have to give the exact correct dimension, whether it's 5810 by 9325 or whatever. That has to be very, very clearly specified. We must also remember that architecture, working drawings or construction drawings will be used for tendering. They will be used by other consultants to produce their drawings that they are going to be doing. These drawings, if they have any kind of a mistake or an error, can also make an architect legally responsible for anything that goes wrong. Now, this is an aspect which sometimes is not drilled into the minds of the student, that the importance of building construction drawings also goes to that level where, you know, you can be legally held responsible for a mistake. So therefore, the accuracy, the technical correctness becomes very, very critical. And must, since this is our communication tool with the rest of the world, as teachers, we must help students develop a sound vocabulary for the effective communication that is required. So whether this vocabulary is developed on paper or whether it's being developed on a software, I'm not getting into that. I'm saying that my vocabulary has to be absolutely sound. You know, for example, a person who sings, you know, whether the person is using a harmonium to sing, whether he's using a keyboard or a computerized version of a machine to sing, that's different. I'm not getting into that. But his fundamental knowledge of the note has to be very, very precise. Only then will that person be able to sing properly. And that's the point that, you know, I'm trying to drive here, that we have to ensure that our students are able to develop a very, very sound vocabulary so that they can communicate effectively. Aruna, next. Now, building materials is one very important aspect of building construction. And I believe that all building materials have a soul. They have properties which are physical, they have properties which are structural. And what is extremely important is that we should be able to learn how to place them or juxtaposition them correctly with respect to other materials. Now, that is the key to building construction. You know, many a times, what comes first, whether the waterproofing layer comes first or does the protection layer comes first? You know, the sequencing of construction, the sequencing of placing materials is extremely critical. Building materials also affect the process, the time, and the speed of construction. This is another aspect that, you know, students must be constantly made aware of. And we also know that building materials are constantly evolving. New technologies are coming in, new developments are happening. And every day we see new products coming in. There was a time when, you know, technology would change every 5 years or every 10 years. Today, technology can change every 5 days. So, you know, that's the speed with which materials are evolving, the building systems are evolving. And therefore, we have to also teach students how to keep abreast with the changing times and the speed at which technology changes. And if your fundamentals of construction, of understanding materials are sound, students will be able to adapt to material changes, etc., or technology changes in a much, much better manner. And we must also understand that materials must conform to applicable standards and codes. Materials are not something which can be just arbitrarily done. You know, there are certain, every city, every country has a code, IS code, the National Building Code, or whatever, you know, the relevant codes are or standards are. Materials must conform to that. And students must simultaneously look at these aspects. Materials cannot be taught without reference to codes or standards or, you know, procedures laid down, say, by CPWD and so on and so forth. So how do students learn about building materials and systems? They can learn it from books, from these codes, from manufacturers, brochures, from shop drawings that manufacturers produce. You know, many, many building systems, typically your structural glazings or how your lift installations happen or how a machine room is to be made and so on and so forth. A lot is learned from the shop drawings that the manufacturers produce. Market surveys and samplings are very, very critical. Case studies and therefore site visits. These are the tools that we have at hand through which we are able to impart the architectural education to our students. Simultaneously, please remember at the background somewhere, I'm not elaborating onto this, but just wanted to you know, keep you about the thing that human eye sees objects as a whole before perceiving the individual parts, and real experiences lead to rational thinking. Now these are two things that as construction teachers we must remember, and as we go you know, forward, you know, I'll you know, be referring to this, not specifically to these two statements, but just keep it at the back of your mind as to what this is. Yeah, next. So let's come to, you know, what is the teaching methodology? You know, typically a building construction class may be divided into two portions, a lecture and a studio. A lecture is typically 1 hour where, you know, one teacher is either delivering a lecture. In some cases, okay, there could be multiple teachers who are delivering a lecture. And then followed by a 3 to 4 hour studio with 3 to 4 teachers, depending on the student to teacher ratio. You know, this is extremely critical for us to understand that, you know, while this teaching methodology, this system is laid out there, how teachers make the best use of these 4 or 5 hours of building a structural studio is also very critical as to how the time is divided between the lecture and the studio, and how the lecture leads to what happens in the studio. So, you know, typically lectures have to be given in a very, very proper manner. The topic has to be introduced in the first 5 or 10 minutes. The entire description must be given over the next 35, 40 minutes. And then the topic should also be either closed or should be discussed as to where we go next after we've learned this. And then in the studio, when the students begin to you know, detail out whatever the topic has been you know, studied that day through individual or collective crits, through presentations. And then, of course, we also try and dovetail case studies and site visits for students to be able to understand. So while we are, you know, discussing what we are discussing here, I have these 3 questions for all the teachers who are attending this session. And I would want you to, you know, think about this. And, you know, maybe towards the end, you know, we can interact on these issues. Question number 1 to you, do you think teaching building a structure is difficult? Question number 2, are there any challenges that you face while teaching building a structure? And question number 3, I mean, please don't take this question in any other way, but then, you know, let's try and answer this question. That do you prepare a formal lecture or a set of notes or a presentation for the class that you are taking? So while we, you know, you all think about these questions, we'll come back to these questions towards the end. I would certainly want to hear your opinion as to, you know, how you approach building instruction with your students. So as building instruction teachers, we have to take students from the known to the unknown. See, we must remember that students are not a walking encyclopedia of knowledge. I mean, neither are we. We are also learning every day. But students have to be taken from what they know, step by step, to the next level of what they do not know. Many a times, we expect students to learn things on their own. We would introduce a topic and then tell them, okay, go and do some literature search. Go and do some search on the internet. Come back, make a presentation and share it with everybody else. Sometimes, this methodology works, but by and large, I don't subscribe to this methodology where we tell students to go and, learn on their own, make a presentation and come and teach everybody else. That's not the best approach to follow. So we should be guiding them from what they know, what they've learned in the previous class, and take them to the next level. This, I think, is extremely critical and must be kept at the back of our minds while we are teaching. And depending upon the topic that we are introducing, the subject could be either taught from the part to the whole or from whole to the part. I will also come back to this in the subsequent part of the talk that I'm giving. And while we are teaching, I think we must try and give our best experiences to the students. Now, best experiences do not necessarily mean that everything good that we've done in our lives. The best experiences can also mean the mistakes that we've made and what we've learned from those mistakes. So when we learn from a mistake, that also, I think qualifies as a best experience. Yeah. Next. So let's look at, the BC syllabus, for example. I have tried to list the topics that we teach in the first and the second years and the topics that we teach in the third and the fourth years. Please remember, this is not an exhaustive list. I've just put in alphabetical order whatever topics that came into my mind and would fit in one column. So, in the first year, these are the topics: arches, walls, vault, ceiling, floors, foundation, furniture, lintels, and so on and so forth is what we would be teaching in the first and the second year levels, in which are typically components of building construction. When we move on to the third and the fourth year, not only components, but we also start talking about systems in building construction. So, we could be talking about basement, the building core, the skin, curtain walls, firefighting system, HVAC, prefabrication, skylights, steel structures, waterproofing, and so on and so forth. I mean, the list is endless. There are other topics which are also being taught. Now, if you very carefully look at, what I'm trying to convey here is that while what we are teaching at the first 2 years, these topics can be taught from part to a whole. While when we get into systems and more complex topics, it becomes more proper to teach the subject from the whole to the part. So, what does that mean? What basically this means is that while I can teach, one of the key differences is that, all the topics which can be taught from part to whole can actually be taught in isolation. I can teach a student what a foundation does, even in isolation, and then, yes, explain its application in the building. I'm not saying that the foundation is totally devoid of my understanding about how the building works, but all these topics can definitely be addressed, on an individual level, and then they can be explained to the students as to how to put them in the building. Whereas, the more complex topics and building systems that we are teaching, for example, the basement in itself, which is being used for parking and services, cannot be understood if we don't understand, if we don't understand what is dewatering, if we don't understand what is waterproofing, if we don't understand how a structural system works, how your ramps go into the basement, how your parking happens, and how your firefighting happens. So all these things, therefore, become very difficult for us to teach in isolation. In the meanwhile, you could go to the next slide. These, should be then taught from the whole to the part. Yeah, next. when we are teaching at the first and the second year level, the components are simple, relatively easy to understand, as I said earlier, and can be taught in isolation. And they may not also require a very deep understanding of the structural system and building services and so on. But the more complex topics and more complex building systems involve more than one component and therefore cannot be studied in isolation. They also require application of the understanding of structural system and building services that the students have learned over the first 2 years. So now this is a fundamental difference between teaching building construction in the first 2 years and then the remaining part of the architectural education. And I think in the third and the fourth year, the students have also started experimenting, as I said, with the computer software, etc. They are also now struggling with the fact that they do not know the technology to the extent that they need to know. And that transition also takes a toll on the amount of time that is required for students to be able to produce a drawing. Now, that's a very different debate or a different discussion. I will not bring it here. That has a lot to do with how software should be taught to the students and at what level the software should be taught to the students. I'm not getting into the syllabus part of it. Yeah, next. Now, coming to what the core idea of today's conversation is, the project-based approach. See, by now, I had been trying to build the case in point that, building construction should be looked at from the perspective of whether it's being taught from part to the whole or from the whole to the part. And of course, every teacher is free to, adapt to whichever methodology that you think is most appropriate for your. But, as I said in very early on, our design-centric teaching methodology always makes us believe that the design project which is being done in the design studio is purely the story of design. While structures and services can be studied in isolation, they are there, those subjects are around. But what is architecture? Everybody has their own definition of what architecture is. I have tried to put in what I feel architecture is. I think it's a synthesis of these four things. The wholesomeness of humanities, the logic rationalism of science, the imagination and passion of art, and the technology, all put together as one. This is what architecture is all about. And whatever we've learned from these four aspects, and when we put them into professional practice, that is what brings architecture to our thing. But is it appropriate to look at design, construction, the structure and the services as a separate subject? Okay, maybe for the first 2 years, when all subjects are new to the students, they are still learning the fundamentals of the various aspects of architecture, it is fine. But then I think by the time we reach third year, the last 3 years of architectural education are very critical. So from here on, I think the entire project-based approach should be adopted even for teaching construction, even for teaching structures, and even in the design studio. Most schools today, are adopting this methodology where, the main project which is taken up in the design studio also has application into what you're doing in construction. For example, what you've designed in your fifth semester becomes your working drawing project for your sixth semester or seventh semester, in whichever way your syllabus is structured. Let's go to the next slide, please. So let's look at the kind of projects that we do, say, in third year, fourth year, and final year. We do institutional buildings. We could be doing commercial complexes, housing, hotels, and malls. There could be transit-oriented development projects, which are a very which is a new thing, and most schools are taking up these kind of projects also. Hospitals, there could be transport hubs, there could be mixed use projects, and so on. Now, all these projects, you will realize, if you look at the lists that I've drawn up on either side, all these topics that we look at in our building construction studios, whether it's basement, parking, structural grids, the building core, firefighting system, large span, lifts and escalators, a building skin, the curtain walls, the HVAC, even passive strategies, prefabrication, service floors, skylights, atriums, steel structures, terrace gardens, etc. Now, all these aspects have to be taken into consideration by the students while they are addressing these designs. The design studio, the design faculty will always insist upon students that they must look at all these aspects and address all these issues when the design is going on. And building construction, I think, combines the logical rationalism of science and the resources of technology. Now, this is something that we need to understand as teachers, and our entire teaching methodology should now shift to a project-based approach where all the subjects begin to get combined, though their teaching is going on separately. But the students are being told or being taught how to combine the learnings from all these studios and create a thought process in which they are able to synthesize all these learnings and, you know, adapt them in design. There is no point in designing a building if I do not understand how its structure is going to happen or how I'm going to, you know, add the building skin onto it. Today, a lot of students are in the higher classes, starting from third year itself, are dealing with parametric design. So, you know, of course, there are software rhinos and others which they use to, you know, develop that. But at the same point in time, with all the complexity that, you know, parametric design allows students to deal with, they still have to answer questions as to how this whole thing is going to be built and how it's going to be brought to reality. And this is a question which can only be answered if the learnings from my structural studio, from my construction studio, from my building services classes is all put together as one. And therefore, the building construction, I think the studio becomes extremely important, because in our construction studios, we are trying to create drawings or learning the communication methodology through which we will be able to explain what we have, you know, what we want to design and, you know, how it is going to be built. Next. So the project-based approach, because the projects have become very large and complex, the sheer scale of the projects that, I listed in the previous slide can be very overwhelming for the students. You know, even for teachers who are teaching design, you know, to be able to take students and bring them into reality with, you know, the scale of the project that is being talked about is a pretty arduous task. And a lot of design teachers have to spend a lot of energy and time trying to, you know, bring the students in sync with, you know, the scale and the detail in which the project has to be thought out. And at the same time, these projects also deal with issues of bylaws, the structural system, the services, the environmental issues, facades, forms, and concepts based on technology, as I said, even parametric design, and so many things that students have now started to experiment with. And these kind of buildings are happening. Free forms are something that you know, students are very keen on adapting or for their designs. And therefore, to be able to bring those concepts to reality, both in terms of construction and to be able to draw them correctly, I think is where the building construction teachers come into play. And students are also encouraged to explore all aspects through their designs. And as we see today, most students have started integrating their knowledge of structures, building system, services, construction methodologies in design. And I don't think there is any debate, and there should not be any debate as to, you know, between design or construction or, for that matter, anything. I think I will leave it here, and I will ask, you know, request Tanya to, you know, take it forward from here. Thank you.
Thank you, Puneet. Aruna, can I have the presentation? And address questions.
And they can discuss. Puneet had shared some questions. They can discuss.
So I think this is the third day, and it has been a very intense and interesting session from day one on. There were so many aspects related to the construction and the building industry that have been discussed. The various perspectives have been given from the angle of the softwares getting in, or how the teacher needs to be prepared, or what are the softwares to be taken in, and what is the entire paradigm of being construction that needs to be built. So I'll start my presentation here, and Aruna, I'll be requesting you to change the slide. Okay. So we are talking about project-based approaches in building construction, sites and other issues. So there are lots of things as an architect, as a, because we all are from the same fraternity, but look, or when we move into the college campus or even into our classrooms, it becomes a small cocoon where we are talking about imaginary and virtual world, trying to create a newer future, trying to read through books, trying to see presentations, share experiences. But the actual manthan, or the actual work that is going on into the classroom, is for a better and a bright future. Designing for a client which we really do not know at that point in time. So it's the whole gamut of courses that we are learning. Can I have the next slide, please? Oh, yes. So now this slide, like part or the whole. Now this is the question. So I'll ask one to step back some few years, some many years, and be into the shoes of a student. Now a student, and really architectural education, when it starts from the first year, it's quite an unlearning process, because the entire 12 years of school education has drilled into us certain ideologies, certain principles, and we perceive that architectural education is also going to follow in that manner. Many a times in the first year, in parent counseling and in the first year classes, in the first week itself, many students come to us, book list needi ma'am. We have not got the entire where to get the books, the textbooks. So this kind of knowledge, or the thing that this is the prescribed syllabus, this is the kunji, and within this kunji, everything is going to get solved. So we need to help the student unlearn. Now the whole journey, I'll ask everyone to see this presentation of mine from the perspective of the student. When we as teachers go into a classroom and we start describing architecture or any topic of architecture, then what really is the mental map, or what really goes on in the minds of the student? Does he get the final vision that we are trying to create for him? Do we support it by some images? Do those images become the final word for it? So how are we interacting in the class? And to break it all, we have so many subjects. History is also talking about architecture. Services is also talking about architecture. Climate is also talking about. So when the whole is there in front of them, which is undefined, imaginary, yet to be created, the architecture. But all the parts are talking about this one whole thing. The student slowly figures out as to how these parts, first he has to understand the parts and then apply it to become the whole. Now this image I really found very interesting, because it's just understanding the parts and to make figure out what the whole is going to be. Next slide, please. Now, as a class, suppose it's my second year building construction class, and I go and I distribute a piece of paper to my class saying, okay, this is my lesson plan. This is what we are going to follow in the class. So the student reads, okay, this semester we are going to talk about timber, okay, truss. The lecture is going to talk about the joints. Then it talks about the finalization of the architectural house plan, design and detailing, design and detail of the mezzanine. So it's talking about the various components. Now, will I be interested in this? What do you think a student is going to think when a teacher reads out this content? Might look such a bore movie to me, where there is no context, where there is no excitement, or there is no snippet, or there is no trailer. So if I go and start with my first class as to, okay, this is the semester where we talk about timber, and in timber we'll be doing this, as a student, do I really understand what is timber? How is it different from wood? Why is the teacher not calling it wood? Or what is the difference between timber? Is plywood, many students say, is plywood? Ma'am, plywood or ye same hai? I said, okay, let's explore. Arun, next slide. Now, this is an image. It looks, just a minute. Now, this is an image where you see, you really can't make out who he is or why is he having, why is he dressed like this? What are the parts? What are these parts defining? And I don't make out the context or the character. Is he a movie? Is he a common man? Is he a regular office goer? Why is there so much of change in attire? So I need to build a context. I need to understand what is the purpose, what is the occasion, what is the context, what is the season, what is the location, and why are we doing this? So other, I think in the first presentation by Prasansha, we had understood all the W's and how's, H, how and why. So this is very important. As architecture or as building construction teachers, we also need to build a story. Build a story which the student really engages in. It should not be a dull maths subject where there are no characters. We talks about X's and Y's. We talks about number. It is a nameless, faceless character. But whereas in design, there is an imaginary user, there is an imaginary context, there are constraints. Why not have a similar paradigm build around construction as well? We should have a face to this person. The person should have his own needs and character, and then we can build upon it. Next slide, please. Now I'm talking as far as also touched upon the whole, the part, and back to the whole. Now, if I say, I'm just taking a very, because this, I made it that we should all step back and look from the student perspective. Now, if I say we are going for a trekking trip, now a hiking trip, so there is a certain hole in my mind, but we have not gone into detail. Now, if we go into the details of it, there are lots of things that we need to pack, have to secure or make those things into our list of itinerary or list of things to be bought or arranged. And once we are thoroughly aware of the things, critical thinking in terms of what is required, what is not required. Okay, this supersedes this one. And these are the things I'm going to carry on my trip. And then we return back to the whole. The second whole looks much more complete and understood and ready to take on the journey. So this concept I'm going to add on a little more. That is a whole to the part and then back to the whole. So we need to position ourselves at a certain level where we, because as teachers, we have seen that whole journey. We know the final destination. But as students, they are just beginning on. So a teaser, a trailer, then getting into the details of it, and then introducing the entire story. I think it will help engage the student much more. Next slide, please. Now, this is a learning model which talks about the basic whole, part, whole learning model. Now, if we introduce the whole, then break it into parts, and then return back to the where the students are exposed to the first, the bigger whole, in which they are prepared for new instructions by being presented a mental scaffolding. So they know the destination, they know the place. Okay, this is the purpose, this is the intent. So to solve this particular intent and issues, we are going to lead into these many ways. The learning objective and building block concepts placed within a larger framework of the topic also serves to motivate learners and provide context to their learning. Next. Now in the second part where we focus on the parts, these are the defined as the details of knowledge, the various parts and bits and parts that we use as alphabets, the elements of building constructions that make or they combine together to make the whole, expertise and the activities. After students have mastered the specific structured material, it is time to return back to the bigger whole. So then we move back and we come to the final, the product. So the second hole helps the student place their newly mastered skill in context. In many cases, the hole cannot truly be understood. Or in case of skills, without an understanding and proficiency of an individual parts, so the return to the hole allows to learn a second chance to at a more nuanced understanding of the whole concept. So when we are introducing a topic, getting into the details, the nitty-gritties, the workings, the material aspect, the construction joinery aspect, the representation, the reproduction of it, and then when the student sees it in a final version, the understanding becomes much more better. Next slide. So the whole learning model is practically a useful template for presenting difficult and complex educational content. So when we understand, like as Aruna has given in my introduction, I take care of the examination, and building construction is one subject where the maximum failure is. Just by the first class, the student decides whether this is cup of tea or not. But as architects, we truly understand that design cannot stand a single daylight without the construction support, without it being constructed. So this is one, as students put, Aruna shared a feedback also from the students that what is their understanding of building construction and how they perceive it. It's a very complex subject as per the student, but if we break it into smaller elements and then make them understand the W's and the H's, why and how we are doing to do it, it makes it fairly simple. So this part or this process of whole part and whole really helps in addressing a complex subject like building construction. And the WPW inspired formats develops the students' cognitive skills on all levels. So they have the knowledge because there is a facilitator, there is an instructor helping the student. Then there is comprehension, because unless you make them really question the W's and the Y's, their comprehension doesn't happen. Then this entire subject has a practical application. So one, anything has a practical application, it registers much more. Analysis, synthesis, and evaluation, because this subject is a very evolving process. If there are newer ways of doing the same thing, as in designers, as architects, we can design a newer way of joint, a newer way of material application. So it is exploratory and innovating also. Next slide, please. So now this brings us as teachers that we should always gauge where am I as facilitators, because this is a wide sea. So we should step back, have a look as to orient ourselves. Where am I? Then where do I need to be? Where is the final point that I need to be? And how do I get there? So the teacher is the pathfinder or the facilitator, and we have to handhold the student from post one to post two, and in some ways handhold, some ways be the guiding light. In some ways, we have to just show them the direction. They'll navigate their own way. So this is a very important step that we should step back and cannot go into the class with set of standard drawings, like this is to be done this way. It cannot be taught in that manner. So the student has to understand the need and the purpose of how and why it needs to be done. Next slide, please. So teaching a practical subject, it can be broken into these new skills. It's either it can be in the instructing mode, the demonstrating mode, applying, or confirming mode. Now, if there are certain topics which are instruction, so somewhere the teacher will be instructing the students to make them understand of certain givens and forms. Now, demonstrating is very important, because many a times we expect the student to follow our verbal command and they will do it. It doesn't work that way, because a demonstration really helps them to see what are the challenges faced during the process of demonstration and what the final outcome is going to be. So it is a key that this is a good demonstration. It cannot be a mediocre demonstration. So it has to be a good demonstration for the student. Now applying this knowledge, the student then practices the skill in a planned situation. So we in the studio, in the classroom, give them case scenarios and where this knowledge and understanding and the demonstration is being applied to. Many a times we feel challenge when it comes to applying this knowledge, where the student comes up and says, oh, I have not really understood. I can't move forward. I'm too scared to touch the drawing board. Can I have the drawing? Now, having a drawing is very different. It really, it's like spoon feeding. Then the mind stops and only the eye and the hand coordination starts where it is in the copying mode. So we have to be very careful in the demonstration so that the process is understood. The why is also answered as to why this is being done like that, why this material is being used. Then once this application is done, then we come to the confirming. Now, this is all about feedback and providing information for the student about how successful they have been. In many a times, architecture itself is called as a practice because it comes by practice again. Many things you learn over and over again. Every time an architect designs a project, many new things come into his vision. Similarly, a drawing or a project done by a student will not be perfect at the one go. So we as teachers have to confine to the learning objectives. What was the intent? Has the student really reached that intent? And so how we are going to take it forward from there. Next slide, please. Now, what is project-based learning? Now, project-based learning is a model for studio activity that shifts away from the classroom practice of sorts, short, isolated, teacher-centered lessons, and instead emphasizes on learning activities that are long-term, interdisciplinary, and student-centered. Now, here we are more concerned, like for the last 2 days, I've been listening. Design the hero of the project. Sometimes it can be that design, definitely the design that you have done last semester can be the protagonist, can be the central character in your building constructions work around it. But why not the project? It can be a project outside where it is taken and dissected in the classroom and understood. There are masters who have designed buildings which do not have building construction done in the later semester. Building construction and design were done on the drawing board on the same time itself. Like HSBC Bank building, you see, the Jubilee Church by Meyer. So these buildings cannot be taught isolation or building construction cannot be a layered. It should go hand in hand. So certain projects, they should definitely want the student to explore.
Tanaya ma'am,
we had done a very interesting semester in the third year design where Amit had proposed to take structure as one of the structure as a main design generating element. So the student had to think about the structure, structural component. That was the governing design, and the design originated from the form. So there are various approaches. So if we have, if we building a structure and design teachers start wearing the same hat or we are given the same glasses to look at things, I think then it's going to be much more, or we should have coffee more. And share the studio much more. It can be a very workable and an amicable way of leading a studio. So the project can be the design project. It can be a project outside. It can be a simple non-star project, but it can be still studied. Whatever is built needs to be studied. After only we have studied it, we can make sense whether it is a good example or bad example or what better things could have been done with it. And why the student buys this project-based learning? Because the moment you introduce stars to him, The moment you introduce the context to him, he buys the idea. He falls in love with the project. Why is design so close to him? Because it's just personal. It is his intent. He has thought about the user. He has given character to the user, the needs of the society. But in building construction, he has detached himself. It is something like just assemblage of certain parameters. There is no character. There is no bonding with the project. So why not do a project base where we give them, I'll show you a few examples where the student have bought the idea, they have generated the idea, and once they start loving the idea, then they don't leave it. They want to see the project to the end. So attendance, submissions, they all go away. So here I was talking about the project emerges from the need of the community also. So there are many schools who have done projects for the near society. Even the NASA trophy is where the students are asked to design and build a structure for the society in the neighborhood is also one aspect where the students don't look at day, night, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, or whatever, and they are totally into the project where they're sourcing material, building the structure, and taking it, filling to industries, because many a times industry people have approached us like the Door Costa, they had approached us for our, they floated even a competition that the student can design a variant or a version of the door and which they will be mass producing and giving the royalty to the student as well. So once these ideas are taken into the studio, lots of newer things can come up. Aruna, can I have the next slide? Okay. So project-based learning engages the student in complex real-world problem solving, and that is relevant to the student and the community. So he finds a bearing, he finds a purpose, and he feels engaged and obligated that he has to complete, he has to make it stand, has to build it. Now, students choose project based on their interest, student learning has value, and the curriculum is real life issues, helping students understand what they are learning and why they are learning. Now, these are the standard family solar house from Freiburg, Germany, where the need for electricity made the person design a house, from one of the cult examples. So something, a need. Now, similarly, students doing a construction masonry workshop and students are working on in the old campus was teaching them about the tensile structures and how large span structures were being built, and the students were totally engaged in making it. Now, can we beat it a standing model 1:1 scale versus a construction drawing of it? Drawing and production and drawing is the main communicator, it's the language, it's the vocabulary architect. But it also, from the student perspective, and if he is built something, the drawing he can learn and process it. The teacher is there to help facilitate. The ideas are very clear with the student. Three dimensionally building, these are the things I observe. The drawing will come in a certain way. Related how the checklist bifurcation or layering of the drawing helps the student sail through complex working. So layer by layer, you keep adding information and it moves forward. Next slide, please. Aruna. The next slide. So I'm going to show you various examples done on campus. Now, site visit is a very integral part of building construction. Many things cannot be done or observed staying in the studio. And there are many material innovation, construction innovation, and things which are getting actually built, because built is to last, and we are all learning to build things. So this is where the students get to read the real world and see what the challenges the industry is facing, or how the industry is coping with various elements. Now, there are various logistics issues faced at a school level, but I'll say we are having the hats of admissions and students, so many doors automatically open for us also. So seeking prior permission, like Puneet sir has very rightly said, that a teacher needs to be well prepared. Himanshu also yesterday pointed the stress, the need that we have to be well prepared in advance. Many a time seeking permission takes as long as 6 months either. And we, knowing what stage we need to go in, the process of permission, sometimes it takes a very long time. So the teacher should be very well prepared with the lesson plan and how to integrate these sites into your learning. Transportation, permission. Now, taking to a site or site visit is no picnic. It has to be briefed accordingly. There has to be a build-up, like the whole. The whole has to be very interestingly narrated to the student. We expect, why is this site important project? And a debriefing is also very much required. Once you come back, lots of selfies have been clicked, lots of pictures have been taken. But what is the takeaway from the site? A debriefing, or debate, or a discussion, turning back to the student, then the entire thing gets lost. Only we have to have a debriefing where the content out. Again, because some certain draft materials like reinforcement, or we say ki corrugated metal sheets and other things, architects or material, we don't find fancy and we don't elaborate and learn about them. So it is where all materials are being introduced. The industry experts or the material suppliers are more welcome to come over and explain to the students. So we should always be in touch with them. Like has been helpful, Somani Tiles, and the door construction industries, there have been many. So we just explore, and we need to reach out to these. There are material innovations. There is many a times in this fast communication, I'll say the internet age, there is no longer the only source of information. We can be just takers of the right in on the internet, how that is all the means. We should not be averse to getting.
Tanaya ma'am, your voice is breaking.
They searching from it. Now, came on site visit, so I take them on the video when it was instructed. Is it
Is it audible for everyone? Because I'm hearing it a bit broken.
Yes, it's breaking. It's breaking.
Is it? It's breaking.
The voice is breaking.
Okay. Maybe can you just pause? I'll connect to a.
Maybe you can switch off your video and talk.
Is it better now? Is my voice better?
Yes, it's better now.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So site visits. Then as a part of curriculum, we also have the OCIS, that is the out-station study trips. So these are very interesting. All the students are very interested. We have seen 100%, almost 100% attendance for these courses. It's a part of the graded curriculum, where the students go and explore various parts of India and the world. and there's lots of learning. Now, why not building construction harper on this or explore what we are seeing in these study trips? They also are a part of learning. So the ancient structure, be it the ancient structure or be it the modern buildings, there is so much to take away. Now, as teachers, we need to do the debriefing from these. We have to ask the student, because unless we teach them how to observe, they will not come back to us and tell us what they have seen in these structures and what was new and interesting. Let building construction or the construction aspects also be an important part of this kind of dialogue. Like the third image where you see is from COEP Pune. It's the College of Engineering Pune. There they have set up an entire working model of all the types of possible plumbing fixtures for, and it is a working model. And it is glass pipes where they have used, and they have shown all the traps. So this was a very interesting innovation where the student went and then they really experienced how the trap function, how the water seal works. So this is very interesting. Next, please. Now, this is something from our school as last semester, because doing is understanding. And when a person does it, then it stays, the learning stays forever. Now, actually making a 1:1 scale arches and the types of arches, it is a very tedious task. The faculty has been very proactive and they have done a scaled model, a proper scale model of all these arches, and the learning and the interest level from the student has been great. Next slide, please. Now, the entire process from making those small bricks, setting the firma out, making the arch, calculating the center, and so on. Yeah, next, please. So this is from the carpentry workshops, getting your hands dirty while mixing the cement, concrete, and understanding, hiring 2 or 3 masons for a day and getting this workshop done, understanding the tensile structures. Next, please. This is constructing the bridges and then the geodesic dome. We had very experimental teachers. We have them in a campus where we are doing lots of learning. Now, when such kind of projects happen, the students get totally engaged and they are so much involved in the project that it really comes across. And the learning is also there. Yeah, next, please. This was some time back that the in the carpentry workshop in the first year, a timber gazebo was being constructed. The enthusiasm the student had, the drawing that they prepared, from the drawing to sourcing the material to getting it on site and the actual construction. So this was kind of a project where the student saw the project on the drawing board, they built it themselves, the association that they have, as well as the learning that they did. This is the amphitheaters in the masonry, the entire work, excavation to laying of bricks, and the entire process. As a part of festival, the students did this masonry work. Next, please. Aruna, next slide. So this is innovating in the new normal. Now in the lockdown period, there were lots of challenges. Since March, we have been in a distant mode of learning. So the students first, because the teacher is on a screen, the 15-inch is the campus. So how the learning has been taking place, like in the earlier session, the multifacetedness of the SketchUp as a software was being explored, and students have really used it to their advantage. They have used the software to first construct 3D models from them. Now, this is how we are exploring. So making them understand the whole and the part and how these projects, because if you make a three-dimensional, no way you can miss the drawing also. Next, please. Now, this is one exercise that we did with the second years. We were talking about the semester talked about RCC construction. And we asked 2 students to take up 1 site in their vicinity, in their neighborhood, and they followed the site every week. Now, I'll just throw randomly a few images, but this was such a big learning that they brought back to the class. Because looking at drawings of plinth beam drawing or the foundation drawing, it was just two-dimensional. Student was thinking it's such a dull thing, but when they actually went to the site, they interacted with the labor, they found the challenges on the site and how it is getting actually built. It was such an engaging experience that this whole semester in this mode, we saw a better percentage of result. The number of students failing because at least the learning was happening. They might be faltering and reproducing in the drawing, but at least when we have a word with them, they were learning. And if they are faltering in the drawing, then it is the onus of the teacher how to show them how to recreate or represent a certain aspect in the drawing. Next, please. Now, the student also made notings of the drawings as well as how the things were progressing on the site and whatever his observation. So whatever the student felt as an observation has been noted down here. There might be technical or nomenclature errors, but the student found certain things. We debated in the class. We set a timetable of half an hour in the morning, first thing that the student presented, the week's learning. It was regular schedule, and then we took on from here. What are the things that they saw? Next, please. So there were so many things, like the student was so amazed, oh, this steel rod is being bent in such a manner. This is the simple setup that it is done on the site and the stirrups are made like this. The firma, or how we know that scaffolding is required or the shuttering is required. But we also see that the scaffolding is done in such a manner. What is the support required? What are the additional equipments which we were totally missing in our building construction class when we were talking about? So orienting them to the practical, they really got engaged in the subject itself. Next, please. So how the drawings were being made, so certain observations and how the drawing represented what was happening on the site and weekly. Next, please. Now, certain things which were not part of the syllabus for that particular semester, but they were being done on the site. Now the sump which was being done, how the concreting, how the retaining work is going to be done. The student was so amazed, oh, concrete has so much of weight, ma'am, that if these scaffoldings are not tied in this manner, it will fall off, the column will not stand. So this is the learning that they got. Okay, the scaffolding is done, that it is cleaned in this manner, it is fastened, it's tightened in this manner, and only this much height is taken at one go. There is a certain ratio which the contractor helped them understand. So there was so much additional knowledge and engagement that the project or the class had, so, and which went beyond just the two-dimensional drawing that was being done in the class. Next, please. So how the progress went on the staircase. So lots of things that we were talking about in the building construction studio was being actually demonstrated on site. They were understanding how it is being laid out. And now this whole presentation came in so handy once this lockdown came in place, so that we could orient or virtually take the student to such sites. So documenting, it's not a star project, it is not one of the known buildings, but yes, this construction technology or engaging with the site has greatly helped us in conveying what we wanted across to the student. Next, please. So there are so many things like the toilet sump or the drop slab for the toilet. If there is a house nearby, what is this black material that is being done? So there were lots of debate. Some student had not seen it. So they debated about it. Okay, why is it required? How the scaffolding is resting on the floor? Why are these conduit pipes left in the floor while it is being casted? So many things like the subjects that were being taught in services and other aspects were also coming into place. Why there is this hole left in while casting in the slab? Why is it that the plumbing also needs to be figured out? So how parallelly all subjects handhold and move forward, that is being taken care. Next, please. This was very interesting. The student found that if you look at the first slide, ma'am, why is this pattern like that? Then the other student themselves thought about, no, we had learned in first year building construction while making bricks, you have to have these two things so that there is proper bonding when the next wall comes. If you see the electrical conduits, this was also a revelation. In drawings, we make them in straight line. Ma'am, they're not taking it in straight line. It is all over the place. I said, why? Just understand what's the process going on. You can't have bends. This was a very interesting, the third top right one. What is the small aspect? None of the students knew it. Why is it being placed? It was something that the class teachers, as teachers, we also miss telling the student. It's the spacers that are being used for the beams to maintain distance. Now, so many things which are actually experienced by a project or going for a site visit needs to be an integral part. We really can't do building construction in isolation. And so many revelations of learning and design also, like sunlight issues, orientation, the views that you get from different levels, all come while visiting a site. Next, please. The kind of equipment, the kind of machinery that is required when the construction is being done, what kind of precautions, what kind of floor planning is required, the equipments that need to be reached, the sequencing of events, sourcing of materials, stocking of labor, getting extra labor for a particular event on the site. So the student learns so much more holistically that as a building construction teacher, I could not have taught them just by making those set of 9 drawings for a project. So there is a very integral need of taking them out from the classroom, engaging with the site, and making them understand. Next, please. Similarly, we had talked about, because we were talking about ramps and basements and other aspects in our design project, in the building construction project. So we had asked them to visit actual places, their malls or wherever they have experience, and then they made their observations. Then they referred National Building Code and also understood. Next, please. Now the service scores and others. So taking these malls, the floor plate, floor plan for the mall, and then understanding where the service score is, what are the fire norms? Because we discussed in class, just telling them that 30 meter is the distance. But when we are actually placing it on a design plan, are we really understanding how efficiently they should be aligned, easy access? So they understood how this entire bouquet of things in a core work, and why is it required in certain manner. So we tried to introduce them. This was not a mandatory requirement for them at the second year level. So it was not done in that detail of dissection and understanding, but yes, and the plan level, they were all exposed to how these are working and how they are being placed in the whole plan. Next, please. Similarly, another example. So as a universal design for learning, now it is not one-way learning, or it is not only for a particular way of teaching. Each teacher, each facilitator has their own ways of bringing or introducing the aspect to the student. So it can be minimum or there can be various ways, modes and experiments that can be done in the classroom, and whichever works well with the student can be adopted further. Next, please. Now I've talked about all that we are doing as facilitators. So this simply says, ki maine to isko sikha diya, but I never claimed that he has learnt it or not. So stepping back and learning from the student is also very important. Whether the student has actually understood, are the learning objectives being met? The whole dance drama or the Kathakali that I have done as a faculty, has the student really understood the story I was trying to tell? So getting back on the other side and looking from the student perspective is also very important. So we can't wait the entire semester to check this knowledge. It has to be done like a pulse check every now and then. Next, please. So sharing the teaching and learning intentions. So you have to make student a party to your class. You both are on the same team. You have to go hand in hand. So compare the different modes of teaching and assessment and describe how they can be applied to your teaching. Describe how you can develop questioning skills, because the moment you start or get interesting questions or the question level increases, that's the time the teacher really understands, okay, this much of knowledge has already been understood by them. Next, please. So the traditional type is instructing, and then suddenly one D-day comes where the assessment happens. For the project-based learning, it's a regular feedback, a formative feedbacks and summative feedback. So we are together in this. If one assessment fails or is not there, we take a step back and redo that entire process, and it is moving in a smooth circle. Next, please. So assessment of learning should not be the aim. It should be assessment for learning. So it is a more check on the faculty. If you're taking an assessment, then it assessment is for the faculty. I think the teacher should be more nervous than the student when the assessment day comes, because it is how well you have imparted. The children are very naive. If something they have really understood, they'll spell it out. Drawing and representation is one aspect of it. That is a skill, that is a tool. If my understanding is there, I can master the tool with practice. We cannot punish the student for not mastering. Yes, as you move on, as you become into the senior years and nearing graduation, we expect that by the fifth year, you should have mastered all the aspects or attributes which an architect should have. Next, please. So there are two ways. It's a simple dashboard. The teacher tends to look it from right to left. The student wants it from left to right. So why not use this method? In the initial phases, it can be self-assessment. It can be debating. It can be a collection of things that has been done till a certain period, compilation of work and portfolio that can be assessed, concept mapping, questioning, teacher observation, teacher design task and testing, and then we put the student. When the teacher has really worked upon, students are like clay. When the teacher has really worked upon it and let the student flower, that's the time the student should be put to any kind of standardized testing. So we should, in building construction also, get into this mode of facilitator. Every assessment, we are on the side of the student and giving them a constructive feedback as to what is happening with you. Where are the things you need to improve? These are the things, and this is how you will improve. So we should be on the student side, not on the other side of the table. Next, please. So now we come towards the end. This is almost the last slide. Sharing the teaching and learning intentions. Now, students should have clear notion of learning intent of the each studio. That is, spell it out at the start of the studio. Now, what am I going to learn? What is expected? What are the key issue that we are addressing today? That has to be very well understood by the student. The learning intention is what you hope student will know, understand, and be able to do by the end of the studio. Now, how do we do this at the studio end? What do I want student to know? Now, it cannot be that entire knowledge is known day one. So there has to be broken into parts. So what is that particular studio entitled for? So how much the student should know by the end of the studio? What do I want the studio or the student to understand? Certain things he has to remember, certain things he has to understand the concept for application. And after this knowledge and understanding, what do I want student to be able to do? So with this set of knowledge, what should be the task or what should be the learning outcome that he should be able to perform by himself? Now, this is the way the approach should be. It can be broken into a single studio approach also. It can be for the entire semester. What is to be known, what is to be understood, and what is the demonstration or what the student should be able to do towards the end. It can be for the entire class, semester, or the year, or the entire course. As an architect, we also, like the architectural education also answers these three questions. What is the set of knowledge that an architect should have? What is the understanding level he should develop? And what is the expected outcome from an architect? Next, please. Now again, we come back to this image that is now, I think it will make clear, it's the elephant and the six blind men. We should not look it as a part, we can look it as a whole. And that's it. Next slide, please. This is a simple assignment or for a project or a site. So each one can just do it. You can mention or select any project. And what is the intention that you want from this particular site?
Yeah, like
if
I know.
You are wanting to introduce this
these
to
are the
student
time, which is not...
or in the student, then you should identify any site, any project, or any building. And what are the takeaways that we want to discuss in class? You can just make it. It's just 10 minutes or 15 minutes. Just to see that you have bite into my idea of project-based learning or looking at site as an integral part of building a structure. Thank you so much. Thank you for your patient listening. I'll go through the comments. I've still not seen them. Thank you. Thank you, Aruna, for presenting.
Thank you, Tanya. I think we jump straight into it. People have any comments? If there are any comments, if there's any questions.
Yeah, Puneet was saying something.
Can we request the participants to, you know, maybe share with us the answers to the questions which you know, I had asked early on, the three questions which we had posed to them. If, you know, any participant and or a few participants want to share with us their response to those three questions which I had asked. Do you think teaching building construction is difficult? And what are the challenges that you face while teaching building construction? And do you prepare formally a lecture or a set of notes or presentations for the class? Would anybody want to share a feedback on that?
I would like to try, maybe I will just share what I was thinking.
So
the first question, do you think teaching BC is difficult? It's a bit of resistant. I feel a bit scared because I always feel that I'm not enough prepared. ऐसा लगता है वो एंडलेस है जितना ही करो वो कम है बिकॉज इट्स एन एंडलेस इट्स अ वेरी वास्ट थिंग एंड यू कीप ऑन अपडेटिंग थिंग्स सो आई ऑलवेज फील आई एम अंडर प्रिपेयर्ड एंड दैट्स व्हाई आई एम सेइंग इट्स इट्स इट ऑलवेज फील बिट स्कैरी बिफोर गोइंग टू बीसी स्टूडियो व्हाट आर द चैलेंजेस यू फेस व्हाइल टीचिंग बीसी आई थिंक this one challenge which I face is that something which is there in the drawing to make them realize that why physically it cannot happen. So you know, ramp mein aap andar ja rahe ho but head height nahi hai, but to make them understood that nahi ho sakta ye. So to do this continuous to and fro between the drawing and why physically it's actually not possible. I think that's one of the challenge. And the last question is, do you prepare a formal lecture note presentation for the class? For BC, I haven't done. I've done for the theory classes, but not for BC subject.
Okay, anybody else? But I think all your answers to your questions lie in all the answers that you've given to these questions.
Okay.
I think it's all about being prepared for the lecture. You know, okay, any subject can be endless. All our experiences are endless. You know, all subjects can be endless. And that is why I was trying to focus or draw your attention to the fact that we must prepare ourselves when we get into the class, when we're teaching a particular topic. So the moment you begin to prepare, you also draw a boundary as to, you know, what is it that you're going to teach. And to what extent you want to teach, and then of course, you know, where you take it to the next class is a different issue. So I think the moment you are prepared for the class, you will not find teaching building construction difficult at all. And the challenges that you said, you know, whether to how to explain what is not going to happen, what is possible and what is not possible. I think again the answer lies in the ability of the student to be able to draw it. So if you are able to draw it correctly, you will find the answer whether it can be built or whether it cannot be built.
But yes, sir, again, the ability of drawing, I am not assuming that, you know, 40 in a batch will be able to draw to that accuracy. I'm thinking maybe someone is good in some other skill. Someone is actually better in explaining rather than drawing. Usko samajh aa raha hai, wo bol pa raha hai, par shayad wo drawing mein translate nahin kar pa raha hai. Usko dotted mein dikhana hai, overheads ko ya uske niche jo hai. So, so that's what I'm saying. Translating from one medium to that is, that gap is so huge. And maybe not everyone is at par to able to produce that kind of drawing.
Okay, I mean, though I don't agree that the gap is huge, but I will still grant it. However, I believe that this gap has to be bridged. You see, that's what we as facilitators need to do. We have to bridge this gap. And please understand, you know, let me break down, you know, earlier on I had said that every drawing has a purpose. Now, to me, a drawing comprises of a certain type and number of lines and associated text. And all we need to understand is how to draw which line, where and correctly. At the end of the day, it can be broken down as simply to, you know, this kind of emotion. You know, there is always this question, you know, which I pose to students, you know, third year, fourth year level. And I'm very sorry to say that most students tend to get it wrong. And it's a multiple choice question. Sorry, I should have kept it handy. As to how do you draw this open well staircase on the lowest floor of a building? So, you know, where is the continuity line, whether the cross of the open well is dotted, dashed or continuous, you know, and I'm telling you, 90% students get it wrong. And if I ask somebody a question, which is that one portion in the building where the cutout line is always a continuous line? Most, even teachers will not be able to, you know, answer this question. Can you think of that place where you draw a cutout and it is going to be a solid continuous line and not dashed? Can you tell me?
So, Puneet, yeah, I'll also, yeah, Srijani, please answer, then I'll come in here because there are a couple of comments from the audience.
The idea is not to challenge you. The idea is that the point that I'm trying to drive home is that we have to make students understand that drawing correctly is what is required from us. We have to draw correctly. Once we know how to draw correctly, half our troubles are over. So anybody else, you know, wants to put an answer to those three questions that I posed?
I would also like to present the student feedback that we received on similar questions that we asked. Okay. It's a group of 100 plus students. I'm just going to present my screen. The number has increased ever since, Puneet. It's 123 now.
Wonderful.
Students are very excited to answer this. They think it's going to really make a difference in their lives. Hopefully it will. We'll all know.
I'm happy that you were able to conduct that survey, you know, it was very nice.
Yes, that was, I mean, came out of ideas with you only. Let me just share the screen and we can continue this discussion around that.
Yeah. Okay. Also, okay, sure. Puneet, Preetam has written that I completely agree, project-based approach. This is for you. And but also I think somewhere down the line we have forgotten the geometry of form. So do you think stress on geometry will help us teaching construction better at some level?
See, building construction is all about methodology. Geometry, form, free form, everything else is something that, you know, one would explore in design. In no way does building construction limit your thought process as far as geometry or form is concerned. I think building construction is all about methodology. And it's totally open-ended. It doesn't limit you. Okay. I hope that's what Preetam is asking for.
I just wanted to jump in over here, look at this question and look at the answer. I mean, the overwhelming number of students are saying they find drawings and sketches most relevant when it comes to understanding the content of a building construction course. There's nothing much to say after this, right?
Yes. I think it really endorses what Kanhaya and I have been talking about since morning.
So, looking at the problem, did you face any questions in communicating your ideas on an online platform, right? Most of them are saying no. Which mode of submission was most convenient to you? Most answers are AutoCAD drafted drawings. Of course, SketchUp models are moving up. I think it's more about their lack of skilling, right? So if they did have the skill of doing that, they would probably go up, right?
It also depends on whether the respondents are from the first or the second year or from the higher classes.
Most of our respondents, almost 50% are second year and 30% are a third year. So we do have a large group of senior students actually saying this. Also look at this this question. What do you like most about building construction studios? I think this deserves a bit more of an analysis right here. Puneet.
Okay. Yeah, can you just read it out for me? I'm unable to see the whole thing. Or maybe if you enlarge it a bit.
Yes, but it's on a form, so I can't enlarge it.
What do you like?
In your screen, can you...
You can zoom
off
your screen.
Well, on Mac, I don't know how to do that.
Control plus?
Control? Nahin, command aayega kuch.
I think you
want to present it, Srijani? You want to present it?
About 20% students feel that the level of detailing is what they like. While 27 or 28% people feel the making of the building itself. So if you combine both, I think 50% students believe that the project that they are doing or the way it's being detailed is what is very important about building construction. So I think again that endorses the viewpoint that we've been trying to propagate here, that eventually architecture has to be built, a building has to be built. And if students have begun to appreciate that fact, I think a good job is being done.
So here's another question. What do you find most difficult in building construction?
Right.
So most of them say they don't find any of these points difficult, but they don't remember specification of materials. So there's some issue of memory that's associated with it rather than...
Though this is a very interesting point. In the early part of my conversation, I had also talked about the fact that materials have to be learned from the codes, what I think missed out was from the specification sheets. The way building materials are written in our specification codes is also extremely important for students to understand. Now, specifications, of course, is a subject which is taught, I think, at the third or the fourth year level, third year level. But I think if it can be dovetailed with building construction, I think it will make a lot of sense. Now, for example, if you pick up the CPWD code, for instance, and pick up anything, any process, waterproofing or anything, that the way it is written there, the way it is taught in the building construction studio as a lecture part of it, or the way it is written or drawn, there are three things which sometimes really confuse the students. And I think in the building construction studio, we should be able to bring all these three things at the same level. So yes, specifications, the way they are written in our code books, should also be part of the teaching that happens in the building construction studio.
They also don't understand structures. There's one more issue that they have highlighted. None of the above.
I like technical drawings. I don't like technical drawings.
If they don't like technical drawings, then what are they doing here? I'm sorry, I really can't help that.
It's very interesting to correlate that here they say that I don't like technical drawings. There was this one question where they were asked that, I think it's a previous question. So what do you like about the building construction? Here they say that they like the making of the building. They want to know what goes behind the building, which makes them result why like building is standing today. So if you see this earlier response, it says,
So you know, the very fact that students are interested into understanding what goes behind building, it means they want to understand building structure. What goes behind building?
This is just the fear of a different communication mode.
Yes.
You know, this is just the fear over here. We also asked a very, a standard question to see what kind of standard response there will be. You do see that architecture design studios have a larger role to play in inculcating this sort of process. I think that's very important in tune with what we were discussing even yesterday, that it is not just the building construction studio, it's also the architecture design studio, which should dovetail with that.
As I said, design is the central part of our teaching methodology, right? So maybe it needs to be supported by the knowledge of structures. That is something that we struggle at third, fourth, even at the final level. People are doing thesis, they are doing a very complicated design, but they still don't understand what a column size should be, or how to figure out what the beam depth is. So when you're drawing your sections, you're not understanding as to how the structure is going to actually come in place. And the focus of the evaluator then from the merits of design actually goes into the wrong detailing. So I think structures also needs to be dealt with in a very, very significant manner in our studios. It has to be brought in. See, you can be, as architects, we cannot hate structures. It is not possible.
So yes, so this is another interesting question. I think our job right now as faculty of this subject, or simply about architecture, and when you say they, for 50% or 48% say design comes first, then we detail. 30% say that details make design. I would have imagined a lot. We should take them to this. Both subjects explain us how to create aesthetics. Structures. Our aim should actually dissolve this.
Design will always remain the chicken and egg story. We can, for the next few centuries, we can continue to debate on this issue, whether design comes first, whether detail comes in first. But as designers, we all know, I'm not talking from the student's perspective, but as designers, we all know, while we are designing, at the back of our mind, we are processing all the knowledge that we have about all the other subjects simultaneously. So the brain, the RAM of the brain is far superior, and we are able to process all the information subconsciously. So design is actually happening simultaneously with all the other thought processes going in. For the students, yes, they have to learn it in piecemeal, and we have to take them to a level where they will be able to process all this information simultaneously.
So yes, so that's why I have to say that we have to aim for this head, which is both subjects explain us how to create efficient and aesthetic structures, where in construction focuses on how structure is constructed.
Do you think we need to bring an element of all the other two heads into every subject? Like for construction, bring design and structures in. From design, get construction structures in. So things like that, maybe blur the these silos a bit by actually, creating worth in the subject.
I'd like to add an interesting example or an interesting pedagogical tool that has been employed in one of the colleges where they have blurred the boundary between subjects, and it's like a whole project that they take for the semester, and for 2 weeks if the design is starting, then the building construction teachers come in and they are talking about the same project and helping resolve what is happening. Then the services also plugs in back to design. So it can be taken as a one holistic whole, and this will greatly emphasize that without one, the other cannot exist. And it is the same, like Amrita has mentioned it very correctly. We are all here for the same bigger whole. So I think some more sharing of faculty and ideas needs to be brought in into the studio.
So I also feel that we should I mean, it's not just about BC teachers come in and teach design in something. It's not that. It's that it's all together. There is a team that is created. The team, I mean, and it's just seamless. It's not now it's the time for BC. Now is the time for design. That kind of approach is like we've discussed even yesterday many times. It has a logic. Management issue which we have to see how to go about it. But beyond that, I mean, as a practice, an idea of practice, it's something that might be viable and can be tried in small pockets, maybe, to see how it works, right?
Correct. So this was, I think, a very good survey that was at which, you know, when ma'am was talking about, you know, the lockdown period where classes were being conducted, and I was also involved in some of these online sessions with SPA students, you know, where we had to complete. So one very important aspect that, you know, came up, which I had been discussing with my other co-faculty also, and we all agreed, yes, that's a very important aspect, is the fact that how well can a student communicate? It means I'm talking about verbal communication, not in terms of only drawing, but even verbal communication. When you are not physically present in front of somebody and you are talking over through a camera, how good you are with your verbal communication skills is also an aspect that I think we need to train our students in. And verbal communication proficiency can only come in if you are technically sound. You know, your knowledge is technically correct. So you can use the right terminology, use the right kind of vocabulary or the words that are required for proper communication. So I think this is a subconscious exercise that we must embark upon whenever the schools reopen after the break, to ensure that students also are able to communicate well.
It needs a lot of preparation, which was the third question you asked.
Yes.
You can't do this without preparation.
Correct. So all these three questions are interlinked. Actually, if you can read between the lines, I mean, they're all the same. So, and I think Srijani, when she answered these three questions, all the questions she posed, the answers were already there in what she was saying.
I think it would be interesting. See all our answers here on this forum that individually people might have in context with this survey. You know how we perceive and how it's perceived. It would give us a very different picture, which we wouldn't realize otherwise.
True.
So again, that's another job you've given it. We will float a form to our participants and have another round with them.
That would be a good. Yes.
Yeah, our participants are getting homework every day. So we are trying to get them to give us back.
I think that sort of doing is what makes it interesting.
I'm sure all our participants who've been glued to these sessions very dedicatedly, they actually would be very happy doing this homework because we're all here to learn. You know, none of us are masters of any kind. You know, we're all learning every day through our experiences. So,
yeah. There are some people have written some comments. So Preetam's I had already read.
Preetam's question he's asked, or it was a comment.
Yeah, I've already asked, and Puneet has answered that regarding geometry. So other people also, please jump in if there's something anybody wants to say. And otherwise, I'm going to read out Dr. S.P. Anchuri has written that. For Tanaya, that PBL is a nice idea. I think implementing this model needs rescheduling as the semester requires, it is a short semester, usually strict calendar. However, as you said, exploration discussions, just a comment, no question. So it was very nicely presented. Yeah, that's a compliment.
Thanks.
Okay, Alpi is saying that I like the idea of the on-site observation log, and I tried that for an interior project. It made sense. It's almost like an on-job training. I think that's a very good takeaway, to create a log. And Yeah. Preetam, you want to ask something? Preetam, you've written.
Yeah.
I'm just going from the
back. No, I was just trying to answer after Srijani the three questions.
Yeah.
That was also. Yeah. So so my answer to the first question, that is teaching building construction difficult? Yes, it is difficult because every time it is changing and evolving. So as a faculty or as an architect, you need to also get into that mode of what's new or what's obsolete. So that's the reason why it is very difficult. And second thing is to make students understand that this is a vital part. It's the teaching BC is also difficult. Why? Because even myself as a student during my graduation, I probably also ignored BCM for a long time. Then when I did my master's, it was this guy from Spain, Auguste Oboil. So he had a good firm in Europe. They have a good construction firm in Europe. So they used to teach construction only on the basis of lines of forces. So he was a structural engineer, but he had worked with n number of eminent architects, and he never used to give us those formulas or those drawings. Everything, even a complex building as a stadium to a high-rise building, was always deduced to lines of forces, which I think was a better and way of understanding construction, that okay, this is how the lines of forces and this is what the material behavior is. And if you can understand these two things, which sir, you said very rightly, the methodology, if you can understand those two things, then probably you have a stronghold on structures, you have a stronghold on materials. So that is something I find during my master's was very important, which has I have been trying to tell students also, like reducing a bridge to its lines of forces, just compression tension. That makes us interesting because as architects, we always try to see things visually or graphically, not as numbers. And so that's it. And I do prepare a lot because I get nervous when it comes to building construction classes. So I do prepare a lot. I do upgrade my older presentations and my older models. And I want to share one experience which I had in my previous institution with Gurdev Singh. So Gurdev sir came for a workshop, and so he also was on the same line, introducing the human body, lines of forces, how one incline himself. So his takeaway was the way humans behave. It's the same way the structures also behave. So if you can just relate things in that way, then it becomes really interesting.
Right.
So that's what my take on construction is. That it could be broken into simpler parts.
Sure, I totally agree with you. Totally agree with you.
I think we'll ask Abhimanyu Bhatia also to say something because he teaches. He has taught with us at construction, and he's also teaching structures. So, and he's written that they should be synced. So. Abhimanyu sir, okay, he's not saying anything.
Yeah, wait. I was just putting on my mic and camera. I think all the three subjects should go in sync with each other. When we are doing design projects in the design studio, we should correlate the same design with as we are doing already in the BC studio, and similarly on the similar pattern we should start teaching structures and make the student understand the concept behind the construction detailing and all the things, so that they all go together, you know, everything goes on together during the entire semester. That would make a learning more concrete and better for students, I think. That's my take on all three of the subjects, because we can't ignore. I was really depressed to see the choice of students being very meagre for structures, like it was barely 17%, and it was very depressing, and I was literally in tears, like, what's happening? So
but sir, it has to be taken with a pinch of salt. We named the form Survey for Building Construction. So they were already in their mind, answering one thing.
But structure is a very important aspect of building construction, actually.
Absolutely. It's probably from our end. That's why I'm saying a pinch of salt.
No. So, yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Abhimanyu. So, others? I think, Tanya, you wanted to say something?
This is just interesting discussion.
That's all right, ma'am. I think we're both used to it by now. Yeah. So I think while answering these questions, I would take up the third question first, that do we really prepare for it? Yes. So when we are entering a class, I think we really prepare for it. And then is it difficult? It seems difficult and challenging because of the actual professional exposure that we have in our own profession, because I think that nervousness comes from there as well. Somebody who's exposed to a lot of large scale projects would probably, you know, step into that class with a lot of confidence. And so people who are starting new in profession would probably be a little, a little nervous while entering the class, taking a building construction class. So it's always a daunting task. I think it seems it comes across that way to us. And the challenges would probably, as a personal experience, I've learned more in a building construction class than I did while I was studying or while I was working on site, because the sort of questions, the sort of detail, you know, very minute questions that would put up in class. So if you're aware, great. If you're not aware, then a person, like, we have a lot of senior faculties we work along with, so they're always there to pick up the pace when we get stuck somewhere on a minute detail or somewhere like that. But then I think it's good for us because we go back, we research that point, we learn a lot. So there's a lot of learning that happens for us as well as for the students in that class.
Right. Very well answered. I think you've lent that right perspective to, the very intent behind these three questions. As I said, they're all interlinked and the answers lie within themselves. So, which is absolutely all right. But yes, just because some teachers have had lesser amount of experience of building, that does lend a little bit of, that scare into them that, construction can be extremely difficult. But that does not stop any faculty to associate themselves with, some construction project which is going on and learn things hands-on. I don't think it's extremely difficult.
So that's sheer
observation of buildings which are under construction is also good enough for us to, learn. And that, there's somewhere, I think that hunger for learning construction has to be there. If it's there within this faculty, I think that can also be given or transferred onto the students also. That hunger or that desire to learn construction.
Yeah, that's absolutely true, sir. I mean, we learn and we build that confidence, as we go along. The more we learn, the more,
I'll give you an example, I think, which will also support what, Tanaya ma'am was also talking about. Just allow me 1 minute. When I was in third year in SPA, the chimney at the Rajghat thermal power station was under construction. It was being built with the tunnel formwork technology and was to be as high as 144 meters. We were in third year and we could see that structure coming up through our window. And one fine afternoon during the building construction studio, some comment was made or something happened. So we decided, okay, let's go and visit that chimney because it is still under construction, and followed the entire, you know, getting a sanction and permission process through the school, through NTPC and so on and so forth. Now the point that I'm trying to make here is that, you know, we took all the class, we went there, and we were taken up a rickety lift through that the tunnel, the chimney, to 140 meters because the last 4 meters were only remaining. And believe you me, I have never regretted, I've always regretted why I decided to climb up that structure. It was such a scary sight. To see Delhi from 144 meters was a different experience. To be standing on a rickety scaffolding at 140 meters high, with so many students suddenly coming out of nowhere, and such a you know, strong wind blowing. Now, all learnings happen in that one moment of, you know, that a fright that you get or whatever. And it opens up your eyes and ears and all faculties in that very instant. And, you know, to be able to work on a height, you know, how people go and work on that kind of a height, 140 meters is nothing today, you know, compared to the kind of buildings that are being built. So I think we can all learn the moment we expose ourselves to actual construction. And there is so much learning that is there, out there in the open. And we have to inculcate that habit, that hunger in our students also.
That's really true, sir. Thank you so much.
I would request,
ma'am, can I ask something? Can I also share something?
Yes, Anupama.
Yeah, I would like to, of the three questions that Puneet sir has asked, I would like to share about the challenge part. So I have been taking second year BC last semester, that is the December 2019 semester. So the biggest challenge we got was, we tried everything. We even tried doing good joinery. We even did the SketchUp things. We did everything. The interest, the engaging was there, but the challenge was to get them to draft for 5 hours in the studio. So that is one challenge. I don't know how to get over that because children don't want to sit in, because second year you have to draft in class, in studio. So that challenge is one challenge. I don't know how to get out of that.
I don't think anybody has the answers to that question. I think somewhere, something that I mentioned in my presentation also, maybe I should have elaborated, is the fact that, you know, building construction drawings are not supposed to be complicated. They are supposed to be as simple as and straight as possible. So I think it always helps in trying to tell the students what all needs to be drawn. Sometimes for the students, it's a huge task. They think that so much amount of information has to go into the drawing, whereas, you know, that can be a deterrent. But if you are able to, you know, list down or break it down into just the amount of work that they need to do, simplify the whole thing, maybe it's easier for students to, you know, approach a drawing and, you know, finish it. It's very difficult for me to, you know, for example, let's take an example. We are doing 5 floor plans, and, you know, every drawing will have to have a door window schedule. So one very common mistake that students make is that, you know, with the advent of computers, I mean, this mistake even gets even more highlighted, is that you have the same door window schedule on all the 5 plans. Whereas your window 7 may only be happening on the second and the third floor. The ventilator V1, V2, V3 may only be in the basement. The V4, V5 may be in the toilets. So, you know, so much amount of information which is not required on the drawings is added on. So if you can try and explain to the students to only limit to what is required on that particular drawing. As I said, every drawing has a purpose. So the first floor plan should suit the first floor, the purpose of drawing the first floor plan, and so on and so forth. So if we can tell the students not to overcomplicate and draw whatever is required or give the information what is required, I think it might just help a bit. I don't know whether this is what we keep trying. This is what I also keep trying. And believe me, we are not always successful.
Thank you
very much.
Okay. I just thought, is Vijaygar there? He has also been with us as a visiting. So, and he's the ex-COA acting president. So, acha, Vijay Garg is not here. Architect Vijay Garg. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So, anybody else wants to say something? Amit? I know Amit is also faculty with us. Amit Gupta?
I think Amit teaching in the third year design studio with new age technology and ideas, maybe something has to be said, can be said about how that integration is being attempted inside the studio. If Amit is here. Looks like everybody's having network issues.
Yeah, today it is quite bad. I think Srijani herself is having issues.
She should just mute all of us and leave, and then remove us from the meeting and then leave.
No, I was having some network issue. I tried to refresh it, so I came back again. Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah. So anyone else? Anybody wants to respond? Anybody wants to say? Okay, I think Vijay Garg has joined. Maybe you would like to say something.
Yeah. So we have architect Vijay Garg here, ex president COA. So sir, would you like to just say, you've been teaching with us and you're teaching at SPS as well. So what would you like to add something? Is there a connection problem? There is some connection problem.
I hope he's heard your question. Yeah, I think he's coming on.
Yeah, sir. We can't hear you.
Oh, I think he's left the meeting again. So maybe
I think network issue. Srijani, just see if he tries again. Please connect him back.
Yes.
Yeah. And anybody else, I think in the comments, Dr. S.P. Anchuri had written that, Puniji, you're right, I follow homework teacher, classwork teacher, students, homework students. So it's very nicely the way he has put it in very old school.
Vijay, Vijay, if you can hear us, we would like to hear from you. What are your viewpoints on the discussion that has been going on so far? You've been teaching at SPA, you've been teaching at Sushant also. So your valuable inputs.
Yeah, I think you have very appropriately explained the methodology of building construction teaching, but I was disheartened to see what Abhimanyu has also said, that preference for design is 67% or rest is contained into 33% or something like that. But what is more important is what we need to convey even in our design class and as a collaborative exercise. The design part is only, again, actual practice is only 15 to 20%, not more than that. Actual things happen when we can actually make them realize on the ground, and that can only happen when you understand structures and building construction well. And I think whenever the syllabus content was always be devised, it has always been insisted upon that we should also create a balance between the three subjects, and all the three subjects should be equally treated as important and main subjects as the backbone of architecture study. Because architecture is not about design. Architecture is not about structure only. Architecture is not about construction only. It is a combined exercise where you create a space and you create an experience by combination of all of them. And that the incident which you actually explained about in the Prastha chimney, yeah. I also remember. See, you remember that we not only went to that chimney, we also went to TV tower that time, and it just on slip form shuttering and going up, which is reducing in diameter over, and you're realizing how it is being done at that point in time. Today, the technology is much superior, far superior, and you can do. But hands-on experience definitely teaches and creates more interest in students. So building construction component, which you said project-based, it should actually be only side study also should at least be 30% component should be side study. And if it is not that included, because the exposure to site and actual projects to students, which relate to lectures and studio exercises, actually will definitely do better understanding and create more interest in students. The how their design can translate on ground. I think I always prefer that even if you call industry people to explain about the product on site, but if you take them, those industry products being implemented and worked on site, it can really make more interesting experience for students to learn and make them more interested. I think that is most important, and building construction is not a easy subject to teach for any teacher, because if you ask 100 teachers, 90% teacher will prefer only design, because there you have to give credit whether you like it or not. You can do say anything and get away, but in construction you cannot get away by giving a wrong detail or not understanding yourself. So construction is not a business of any teacher who can teach. It is very difficult. Even institutions like SPA struggle hard to get good construction teachers. And fortunately, we being in Delhi, we get a lot of good teachers in construction. But entire country, most of the architects only focus on design, because there are hardly any construction teachers available who understand equally construction. And because being in practice, I realized that 90% time, if I don't have good hands on building construction, I cannot deliver, I cannot make money, I cannot earn, I cannot be satisfied as an architect, because I cannot actually deliver what I have designed if I don't know how to translate it on ground. And if the students understand that well, I think they will be more interested. I think there is some counseling exercise or something need to be exposed. Something is lacking in the earlier years of teaching, where the student's interest is more on design and not understanding. Maybe because the more time is given to design studios than construction, but construction is anyway minimum 4 hours compared to 8 hours of design. And we have 4 hours of structures, equal component. But I think that need to be understood very well. And construction is definitely a tough subject, which is very well explained by Puneet and Tanaya. And very well done. A good exercise by Sushant. Thank you. That is what I only wanted to add.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, sir. Yeah. And I think we have, Puneet.
I think that kind of sums up what we've been talking about. So any other feedback anybody else wants to give? Any questions?
I think we've had a long
session, and nobody has realized that we've gone half an hour overboard. So
you know, that's our buffer time. That is anyway a time we've kept. They know that's our interaction time. So we'll request we'll share the assignment.
Yes.
And Amrita, you're saying something.
No, I'm not. I'm just saying the same thing. This is the time for interaction. And I think we've had a very good one. It's been very, very, I think, very intense, very well received. Lots of ideas. We're getting feedback that these are incredible tools that we are getting, being able to impart to our colleagues to approach various ideas. Point well taken. Knowledge, primarily knowledge, is more important than before dispensing of that knowledge in a subject like building construction. So I think all of us need to keep upgrading ourselves continuously, and this is the purpose of this forum. In fact,
I just want to add one thing. So this forum is not essentially like a regular FDP, and that is a point that I think I make every time, every day. It is where we are all together also doing the research, and we are taking part in a training program together. So it is a very this is very different from a regular FDP, and we do hope that this sort of a forum.
Right, our speakers also learn. I've had messages from Suhasini from the first day. Her reply to me was, I had a good time, I learned so much today. Thank you.
So
everybody's learning, I think, and that's the point. Yes, it's not a standard FDP. Thanks for keep saying you keep saying that. Thank you.
I will stop now after today.
All right, I think we are ready for the break for the afternoon and rejoin at 2:30.
Yeah, thank you, Puneet and Tanaya. That was an awesome session. Thank you.
Thank you for giving me an opportunity to be part of this. Thank you very much.
Please do join back in the afternoon, Puneet.
It's open. We'll share the link. You can join in at all the sessions.
It's the same link. Sure. It's the same link. Please join back.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.